We have a dear friend with us today. You know, I've been doing this television gig now for a little over 3 months. He's been doing it for 30 plus years. Maybe he could teach me a few things about TV. But he knows George Beverly Shea. In fact, our guest today knows Billy Graham and Cliff Behrens and George Beverly Shea, some of the greatest people in the world. Ben, hello. How are you doing?
I'm fine, thank you, Earl. And it's great to be with you.
When did you first meet George Beverly Shea?
In Philadelphia, Billy Graham Crusade, 1961.
And you actually worked as a counselor for Mr. Graham, or thought you were going to work but ended up in a different role?
That's right. I went there to learn counseling, and my best friend at seminary gave word to them that I was a former CEO of a newspaper, and I could have killed him at the time for doing it. But it turned out to be a very fortunate thing. So they put me in charge of contact with the press. They had three daily newspapers at that time in Philadelphia. And I also ended up covering the crusade for the Associated Press for the state of Pennsylvania.
What role did George Beverly Shea play in that crusade?
The same key role that he played in all the crusades. Beverly Shea, I think I can say that as a newspaper man, I am skeptical and trained in doubt. And I saw the Billy Graham team behind the scenes, and I can say behind the scenes, if I were being sworn in court, the Billy Graham team exceeds our fondest expectations of what we would hope it's like. It's even better. And the keys to that team are Billy Graham, George Beverly Shea, and Cliff Behrens.
Now, George Beverly Shea actually was on the radio, I believe, in Chicago, and Mr. Graham used to come down to his radio program. Wasn't that some of their early connection?
This is my report, that George Beverly Shea had a regular nightly program, and Billy Graham, and this is generally unknown, I have only found it out in recent years, Billy Graham was first of all a pastor in Western Springs, Illinois, just outside Chicago, and Don Husted, who plays in many of the crusades as the organist, told me that he was a member of that church. And I said, what kind of a pastor was Billy Graham? He says, oh, he was a great evangelist. And I realized he had not answered my question. So I repeated the question, and I said, as a pastor, what kind of a pastor was Billy Graham? He says, he was a wonderful evangelist. And I said, well, how long was he a pastor? And he said, 13 months. And as I understand it, Beverly Shea invited Billy Graham to come on his radio program. So, in effect, he gave Billy his start on radio, rather than it being the other way around that the public would assume.
I believe you told me that Dr. Graham used to go and visit with Bev Shea quite a bit there. I believe it was, WMBI in Chicago, where Bev was an announcer and had his own program.
That's true. And the two of them have just been so close and so loving from the beginning that I remember when Billy Graham a few years ago had his second Atlanta crusade. And at that crusade, Bev Shea said that this would be maybe his last one because he was retiring. And Billy's response to that was, you'll retire when I retire, and I want to do a lot more preaching. So they've stuck together.
George Beverly Shea is fixing to get a lifetime Grammy. In fact, the Citizen Times in Asheville, North Carolina, says that after his birthday today, I think his family is doing some things with him. He's going to head to Los Angeles, and he's supposed to get this this special award. He has sung, Ben, to more people, and this is in the Guinness Book of World Records, more people than any other artist, Elvis, the Beatles, any other artist that you and I might remember. He has sung to more people, and he was asked about that, and he said, well, I really didn't plan it that way. He said, when you're right before the man that preaches, he says, they're going to see you first. But this is a great honor for George Beverly Shea, isn't it?
Well, it's an honor well deserved. I think you told me that he'd be 102 today.
Today is his 102nd birthday.
I haven't seen Bev for about 5 years. Last time I saw him was in Atlanta when he was being honored. And I think the most interesting conversation I've ever had about Bev Shea was with a friend flying from Atlanta to Los Angeles. And we sat beside each other roughly 4 hours. And this man proceeded to tell me that he himself was had quite a voice. And in Los Angeles, he'd been recruited by 14 different choirs in different churches to come and be a paid singer. And he impressed me with how good he was. And he started talking opera. And he talked about opera with the same familiarity that we might talk about football players or baseball players. And I said, do you buy opera records? Oh, he said, yeah, I've got a whole library full of opera records. I buy them nearly every week. And so I listened to him, and I finally said, let me ask you a question. Who is the greatest singer in the world? And he looked at me and he said, well, do you mean man or woman? Are you talking about coloratura soprano, or bass, or baritone? Or what? That's such a broad question. Are you talking about opera? I said, I'm talking about the question. Who is the greatest singer in the world? And after throwing out all these names, many of which I had never heard of, he hung his head and said, George Beverly Shea. And I said, well, I know Bev Shea. I've known him now, at that time, 45 years. And I said, even Bev Shea in his heart wouldn't say he's the greatest singer in the world. And I said, what on earth would make you categorize George Beverly Shea as the greatest singer in the world? He says, because singing is a form of communication from one heart to another. And Bev Shea does that better than anyone in the world. He said, they laugh about me when I go to the shops and buy opera and albums by George Beverly Shea. But he says, no one can argue with my definition of what constitutes a great singer. That stuck with me. And I told Bev that, and he smiled and he said, well, that's awfully nice, and just turned it aside. He's a very modest man.
You were telling me several months ago about your trip to Atlanta, and you had conversation with Mr. Shea at that time. Can you share with our viewers some of the dialogue? I believe you were at an awards program or something where there were quite a few people.
Yes, they were honoring the founder of Chick-fil-A. They were honoring a former governor of the state of Georgia, and honoring Bev Shea for the many years in service and faithfulness to Jesus Christ. And in talking to him, I met his current wife. He was a widower for 12 years before he remarried, as I recall. And I can't say we had any particular conversation that I remember, but he was still the same modest man who always talked about Billy and the team. I've always thought that only the Lord could have put together the team of those three men, plus others that constitute the team. And I remember interviewing Cliff Barish years ago, and I know Cliff and Billy better than I know Bev Shea. And I asked Cliff, I said, Cliff, I was talking to an ad agency man, and he said he would pay you $250,000 a year to do commercials because you're believable and you've got a good face. And he smiled and he said, I make a lot less. I said, I know, I've got a pretty good idea of what you make. And Cliff said, well, that's not what the Lord called me to do. And they all center around Christ rather than around Billy Graham. And that's one of the secrets of that team staying together, in my opinion. I've never detected jealousy within the team of one toward another. And I've seen them behind the scenes. For instance, on one occasion, I interviewed Billy Graham for a Canadian and an American magazine, and they ran it all. And it was a little over 6 pages in a full-size magazine. So, you know, when you interview somebody and they don't have any inkling what you're going to ask, you get more of a feel of the person than you do from reading books. At least that's the opinion of an old newspaper man.
Yeah. Billy Graham, down through the years, has always had George Beverly Shea sing a song right before he preaches. Now, as a minister yourself, how important is it to the sermon to have a selection of music? This plays, I guess, a key role in setting the tone for your message, doesn't it?
I think it's critical. That's why I've often said that Glenn Draper, that I've had the privilege of working with for a number of years, it took me well over 1 year on the telephone. I don't know what my long distance calls cost to get him to leave Miami and to come to Chattanooga. But I've often said that he has opened more hearts for the gospel than I have ever opened by preaching. I think music is critical because music softens a heart. It gets the attention of a heart. And Glenn Draper always produced music before I spoke.
So George Beverly Shea, in your view, provided that same approach as Mr. Graham would take the podium and read the scripture and go into the message.
Yes, and it was always with a modesty, and I'm saying this from whatever knowledge I have of television.
Yeah.
Bev Shea has always put the song as the star and not Bev Shea as the star. And many of your best professionals make the mistake, in my opinion, of putting the song behind them, putting themselves out front, ahead of the song. Well, when Bev Shea has written about a half dozen songs, my favorite is, I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold.
We're gonna listen to that in a few
Are
minutes.
You? Uh-huh. All right. Well, when he sang that, He sang it very simply. He put the song out front. And then he sat down. He didn't say, thank you, or God bless you, or he didn't give a sermonette before he sang. He just sang the song and let it stand on its own with the words. And the words are so important.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to be the star rather than letting the song be the star. I hold that opinion very strongly.
Billy Graham could have changed music directors down through the years. He could have changed soloists, but for his entire ministry going back to, 46, 47, back somewhere in that era, it's always been George Beverly Shea as the soloist and Cliff Behrens as the music director. And I guess if Dr. Graham were still holding crusades today, he'd take George Beverly Shea and Cliff Behrens along with him. What was the chemistry, Ben, that made them work together so perfectly as a team? What was the chemistry?
I think the conviction that not only the Lord had brought them together, but each of them was most used by the Lord as long as they stuck together. For instance, the hardest working member of the team is Cliff Behrens. Cliff used to feed the line for the microphone to Billy as he preached. And I have seen Cliff, I know where he's heard the same message 15, 20, 30 times in different countries. He listened with fascination to every word Billy said as though he was attending his first crusade. It's a childlikeness that I think comes with faith in Christ. I feel much more like a child today than when I was the age of a child.
And Cliff Behrens was the brains behind this organization. He was the detail man.
No, I wouldn't say he was the brains. The final word is usually Billy's. But Billy places himself, I remember in Philadelphia one night, I had seen him at that time at the crusade briefly for a minute and a half, and one night he came up, he said, take me where I'm supposed to go. Well, I didn't know where he's supposed to go. He said, there's a crowd outside and it's raining and they can't get in the hall. This was when they first began. They were three different locations in Philadelphia. And he placed himself in my hands as though he was the patient and I was the doctor, that kind of dependency. And that childlikeness I have seen in a handful of men who are really great men. There's a simplicity to them.
You said you knew, or you know, Cliff Behrens. I believe you brought him to First Presbyterian Church, where you served for more than 30 years. As pastor, you brought him there several times to conduct meetings. Cliff Behrens, he was a great speaker in addition to being a musical director.
That's true. He's an excellent preacher. But if you lined up 1 million men and you were going to choose the finest of the 1 million men, I would save you the time and say it's Cliff Behrens. That's how highly I think of him. He incidentally has a daughter, a married daughter with three children, who live in Dayton, Tennessee.
Oh, okay.
And while Cliff was preaching in our church, baptism came up, and he says, do you allow dedications? I said, we'll dunk them, or we'll... We'll sprinkle them, we'll even hose them down. And he said, I said, we would be honored to have you dedicate your first grandchild. So he did in our church.
You mentioned the song, I'd Rather Have Jesus. And most people identified George Beverly Shea with How Great Thou Art, and I can understand why. But George Beverly Shea tells the story about how he came down the steps at his home one Sunday morning, and there was this poem there. It was either organ or piano, I can't remember which, but it was a musical instrument, and he started just, you know, sitting there putting the music to those words, and the rest is history. Let's listen to George Beverly Shea sing one of Ben's favorite songs, I'd Rather Have Jesus.
Than silver or gold, I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than a houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of reddest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that your hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
I remember Bev's song, I'd Rather Have Jesus. You don't think of that much as a congregation song, but we got to Japan and we were doing some concerts in preparation for the crusade, and we went to a university campus. Beth could tell the story better than I, but they had his song printed in Japanese and everybody sang it, and oh, it was such a thrill for me to hear it and then to enjoy it for Bev's sake.
Bev's sake.
Yeah, it was just a marvelous experience for us.
Bev, I've told this story all over the country. I hope it hasn't got back to you, but we were at your home like 10 years ago or so. And when we got done, you said to me, Bill, do you like catfish? And I said, sure, I love catfish, Bev. Well, I got a favorite place. Follow me. Of course, you live up the hill. So I followed you down the hill, and you were going around those turns pretty quickly when we got down to the catfish place.
Bill, I was going around those turns quickly for you, but you live on the level in Indiana. And I was going probably 14 miles an hour around.
I tell this story all over the country. I said, now, he may be a great patriarch and a great singer, and we all love and respect him, but I tell you what. That day, driving in his Suburban, I rededicated my life to the Lord several times.
That makes a good story.
It makes a good story.
What a delight to have a man who...
And that's a clip from the Then Sings My Soul video put together by Bill Gaither. And Bill Gaither's put together a lot of videos, several hundred. But that's this is my favorite. I love this video. I've watched it many, many times, and we think... Sunshine Christian Bookshop here in Fort Oglethorpe for making it available to us. You were watching George Beverly Shea there, Ben, and he had some good musicians behind him.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Ted Smith, Don Houston on the organ, and each of these men didn't play simply as professional musicians, but as dedicated believers in Christ. Billy Graham has brought together, of course, the basic search of man is for Christ, not denomination. After all, I follow a Jew. I do not follow a Presbyterian. And Billy himself is Southern Baptist. His wife is Presbyterian. His children are mixed. Bev Shea's dad was a pastor in Wesleyan Methodist. And everyone on the team has a different denominational background. And when they come together, denomination breaks down. I have seen women who covered their legs down to their ankles sitting beside Episcopalians who might be wearing shorter dresses, you know. And all of that goes out the window when they go to a Billy Graham crusade. I think the funniest thing on Bev Shea that I can't forget is when they were in West Berlin, and the communists, of course, still ruled East Germany and East Berlin. So Bev Shea and Billy went over into East Berlin, and the communists reported that Billy Graham was seen with Beverly Shea in a bar. And they made Beverly Shea sound like a woman. And of course, a bar is similar to a restaurant in the U.S. That's the way they were speaking of the bar. But they acted as though Billy had some illicit sexual relationship with a woman named Beverly Shea. I've never forgotten that. They all got a kick out of it.
And that was in East Berlin.
That was in East Berlin.
Yeah.
Right.
That really is an interesting story. With George Beverly Shea, Cliff Behrs, and Billy Graham, do you think we'll ever have in our lifetime another team to emerge with such charisma and the capacity to draw thousands and the centerpiece being Jesus Christ?
I have no idea. Because I think that people in the time of Billy Sunday would have thought no one could have ever rivaled Billy Sunday and his crowds. Billy Sunday, of course, made the demon rum the enemy. Satan was to him so real that he would take off his vest as he preached, and he would visually fight with the devil on the platform. A totally different approach than an emphasis than Billy Graham. But I think the Lord may very well raise up some other man, but I don't believe that he'd do it twice. You know, the Lord's so ingenious, he doesn't have to do anything twice. He never does with me.
That's a pretty good way of putting it. It really is. George Beverly Shea is going to receive this award. Here's a quote from the Citizen Times Daily. "We believe that Mr. Shea will be the oldest living recipient of the Lifetime Achievement Award," said a Grammy spokeswoman. "This year, other recipients are Julie Andrews, band leader Roy Haynes, the Kingston Trio, Dolly Parton, and punk rocker the Ramones." I guess that's the way they're pronounced. I'm not familiar with them. But I can see George Beverly Shea now, Ben, when they hand him this Lifetime Achievement Award. He's so humble.
Yeah.
And if I had to describe this man in five words or less, it would have to be his humbleness.
That's true. That runs through the whole team.
And I've known John Andrus, who was pastor at First Nazarene Church here in Chattanooga, relayed to me. He said, I wanted to get somebody to come into the church for a special occasion. So I called and I got through to George Beverly Shea and said, he talked to me for 30 minutes. He couldn't come. He couldn't accept my invitation. But he was so gracious and he was so warm and he was so friendly. And he even sent him some follow-up correspondence. And then I said earlier in the hour about Martha Ragland, who's been at Chattanooga Funeral Home now since 1947. She said she was in Nashville to visit with Annabel Clement O'Brien. And she saw Big Chief of the Statesmen, and he told her that they were going to be making a recording with George Beverly Shea down at the famous Studio B there in Nashville, and invited her and Mrs. O'Brien, who was the sister of Governor Frank Clement, to come down to the studio. And she said, we went down there, Ben, and we spent 2 hours. She says, maybe more time, but says Bev Shea, in between numbers, would look at us and say, ladies, am I doing all right? Am I doing all right? Chet Adkins said, of all the thousands of artists that he recorded for RCA Victor, his favorite to work with was Bev Shea.
That's an interesting comment, because Chet Adkins, in my opinion, there's nobody better than Chet Atkins in his area.
I mean, he recorded Elvis.
Yeah.
He recorded a lot of country acts, a lot of rock acts. But George Beverly Shea, the easiest to work with. Does a person have to work at being easy to get along? I mean.
Oh, sure, because so much of television is just raw ego. And raw ego up close is like fresh meat. I've known women that would cook you a steak but wouldn't eat it themselves because they dealt with it as raw meat. So I think people expect recording artists and people of that nature and people who are in the limelight to be full of ego. Uh-huh. But when you see the humility of a man like Bev Shea, and if you think it through, regardless of whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, you realize this man has something I wish I had, and it's not something that you acquire.
Mm-hmm.
It's a gift. And I think it showed through whenever he sang. He was a bridge between Canada and the U.S. like no one else that I know of.
Yeah. George Beverly Shea, he's 102 years young today. And we're going to play for you in just a minute some more of his music. But I want to change gears just a minute because a lot of people said, I heard you're having Ben Haden on the air with you. Said, can you get Ben to bring us up to date on what he's involved with? Because he's got something that's new to a lot of us, and that's an internet ministry. Ben, can you describe for our viewers what you're doing now?
Yeah, I'm doing something I know little or nothing about. My secretary laughs when I tell anything about electronics because I'm not electronically minded. But I am intensely interested in the internet as being the cutting edge today. And we have a new website. I work half a day, 5 days a week, and a lot at home. And we have a new website with 10 options on it. And the options range. The first option is to 1/3 of all Americans who consider themselves Christian, but who do not attend any church. Now that's by independent, non-religious polling. Then we have messages about Christ that run 5 to 10 minutes. The other one runs 4. Then we have under answers, we get into how do you choose a church? Is the Christian faith easy? Well, I find it much harder to be a Christian than to be a pagan, and I've been both. And we discussed the practical side of the Christian faith, which the organized church, frankly, doesn't discuss very much. They make it sound as though if you come to Christ, you've got it made and you've done all that's asked of you. I think that's the beginning. And, you know, the Bible says if you live godly in Christ Jesus, you will be persecuted. And I don't know many people looking for persecution.
No.
So, but I think that side of the Christian faith has to be spelled out so people are not shocked when they have friends turn on them, socially or business-wise, because they've become Christians, particularly if they become outspoken Christians. And I used to kid, I've only been in two churches, but the first church was in Miami. And I said, to me, Christians are an acquired taste, and I'm still acquiring it. And they were acquiring me, and I was acquiring them. But I have served two of the most opposite churches in America. And I am intensely interested in the unbeliever, because I understand where he's coming from. I was one for so many years. Mm. And I'm also intensely interested in the struggle of the believer, because it's tough to follow Christ. It's not easy, the way people paint it. It's very difficult to follow Christ. And it's more difficult every day, living in the world in which we live. When I was in Miami, I could speak to, let's say, 150 people I've never seen, and I'd say, how many of you do not believe in Jesus Christ? They'd shoot their hands up. Couldn't get them up fast enough. And somebody said, well, it must be quite a transition between Miami and Chattanooga. I said, no, in Chattanooga, if I ask 150 people, do you believe in Jesus Christ, they shoot their hands up as fast as they can get. Because the thing to do in Miami is not to believe in Jesus. And the thing to do in Tennessee is to believe in Jesus. Mm-hmm. To pretend you do anyway.
So you have the Changed Lives Ministry continuing via the internet. Now you also have a radio ministry.
Yes, sir.
And
we're in our 43rd year.
The Changed Lives broadcast on WFLI and WDYN, I believe, every Sunday morning. At 9 o'clock, and these are sort of the best of Change Lives broadcasts that have been aired in recent years. But the focus of your ministry now is on the internet, I take it.
Well, internet and radio, because I have always felt that the intimacy of is what you're seeking in any form of broadcasting. And I think radio lends itself to intimacy, just as television does, and certainly as internet. For instance, in internet, it's always one-on-one, mm-hmm. until now. And now they have the mechanism that you can, by remote control, by a television set with a browser built in so that you can see the internet on your television screen, mm-hmm. without moving.
Yeah.
And that's going to be a new era, and that means the family may watch the internet for the first time, whereas it used to be one-on-one. It's always in a state of flux.
Do you think we'll see in our lifetime, when they have the internet available in cars, if and when that option comes, that's going to really make a dent into the listenership on AM and FM, isn't it?
Yes, but that's true. But I think we'll see things right now that we don't dream of. They are now talking about broadcasting by cloud, C-L-O-U-D, and I haven't even read enough to get the idea. But I think it's the greatest time in the history of the world for the openness to Christ. And there are more ways to reach people about Christ than at any time in the history of the world.
And for our viewers who are watching this telecast right now, if you have any questions about a relationship with Jesus Christ, you go to the internet, changedlives.org, and there's plenty of information there on how you can trust Christ as your personal Savior. And I'm sure Ben and his staff would be delighted to send you helpful literature that will start you off on your newfound life in Jesus Christ, and that's changedlives.org. And for those of us who are Christians and need some encouragement, there's plenty of information on that website that can be helpful to you. I have checked it out almost every day. I listen to many of the, Ben calls them conversations, but the talks that are available there on changedlives.org, and tell your friends about this website. It's a very valuable tool that can help you, whether you're seeking a relationship with Jesus Christ or whether you are a Christian and you're wanting to grow in Christ. Ben, I really appreciate it. I know you're a busy person, and I know you have a lot on your schedule, but I thank you very much for coming and sharing as we celebrate and honor George Beverly Shea on his 102nd birthday. That's a lot of years, isn't it?
It's a lot of years, Earl, and I'd like to say while I'm on your program, how much you mean to this community. Your life, your integrity.
Thank you so much. You mean a lot to me too, Ben. He's one of my favorite people. We talk for hours. I mean, Ben's got so many stories about the newspaper business and being a journalist myself, why they're of interest to me. We're going to leave you today with some scenes from that Then Sings My Soul recording with Bill Gaither and George Beverly Shea. And Bev Shea, you might be watching this telecast on the internet since we're now on the internet, but happy 102nd birthday to America's beloved gospel singer, George Beverly Shea.
You wrote this song, and we stopped by your house up in Chicago, and we said, Bev, I want to show you this song.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
There's just something.
There is something about that name.
Master, sing it.
Master.
Savior.
Savior.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Like the fragrance.
Like the fragrance.
After
the rain.
Jesus, sing it.
Jesus. Jesus. Jesus.
Let all
heaven proclaim. Kings and kingdoms
will all pass away.
But there's something.
But there's something.